I call upon your feet like wine for you to drink, like water from my heart. I pour my love on you. Yes, God, if praise is like perfume, I'll lavish mine on you till every drop is gone. I pour my love on you. Sing it. Like oil upon your feet, like wine for you to drink, like water from my heart.
Oh, I pour it out.
Smile, yes, God. On you. Oh, till every drop is gone.
I give it all, Lord.
I pour my love
on you. Yes, I do, Lord. Like all, like all.
Like water from my heart.
Oh, I pour my love.
I pour my love.
Yes, God,
on you.
I give it all to you.
With praises like perfume.
Oh,
I lavish mine on you, God, till every drop is gone. Oh, I pour my love on you. Like oil upon your feet,
yes, God.
Like wine for you to drink, like water from my heart.
I pour it all.
I pour my love on you
with praises. Oh God,
I lavish mine on you till every drop is gone. I pour my pour my love on you.
Oh, with praises like perfume,
I'll lavish mine on you till every drop is gone. Oh, I pour my love on you.
My
like wine for you to drink. Yes, God.
Like water from my heart.
Oh, I pour my love.
I pour my love on you.
If praise is God.
If praise is like perfume.
Oh, I lavish
mine on you.
Oh, till every drop is gone. Oh, I pour my love on you.
You.
Yes,
amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. It was pretty cold this morning, wasn't it? Yeah, for some of us, you know. As I saw some teenagers at the school bus today, and I knew it was cold because they had their blue jeans pulled all the way up to here. And I heard it was so cold that the politicians were warming their hands in their own pockets. Amen. That's pretty cool. But I'm glad you're here to be in the warmth of his household. Amen. I want to share with you some thoughts. And again, I'm coming from the Wedding at Canaan. You say, man, are you a slow reader? you know, I think a lot of people say, you know, that does God still talk? You know, does God still talk today? My question or my reply sometimes to that type of a question is, are you still listening? Because you can't have communication if two people are talking at the same time. You ever get one of those phone calls that somebody calls you, but they're carrying on another conversation? And you're like, hey, you call me. Call me back when you're finished over there, okay? And I appreciate the call, but talk to me when you call. Some interesting stuff started developing when I started looking even deeper into this first miracle that Jesus did at this wedding. And what took front and center was his mom, Mary. And it looks to me like Mary knew that he was the only source of help, right, at that wedding. It seemed to me that Mary was the only one with faith at the wedding, although there were a lot of people there. And even his disciples were there, right? Yeah. It makes mention that when he went there, that the disciples went along with him. And so I started thinking, why did Mary have faith there? Okay? Remember, this is the first time he would wrought a miracle. Okay? So how come she had faith and really nobody else there did? See, those are the little nuances that keeps Pastor Mel up at night. And I have to connect those dots. But in order to connect this dot, Pastor, I had to take a time travel of 30 years in Mary's life. And 30 years prior to this moment, because a rabbi started his ministry at 30 years old. That's why 30 years, and he had 3 years of ministry. So he was approximately 30 years old when he entered into this public arena of being a rabbi and a teacher. And so 30 years passed, an angel came to her and told her she was favored and that she was highly blessed and she would give birth to the Son of God. Okay, but you got to hear the whole story. Because 30 years back, Joseph and Mary, they lived under a cloud over the birth of Jesus. Do you remember that? because they were betrothed, and that's a little stronger than an engagement that we have nowadays. And really, to get out of a betrothal to someone, you had to provide a decree of divorce, as if you had been married already, because all of the arrangements had been met. And the fact of the matter is that Joseph knew how serious this situation was, but he loved Mary so much that he was going to send her away privately so that she would not be stoned. So under this cloud, right, of the birth of God, you know, so for 30 years, now let's travel 30 years into the future, okay, in her life. So now she's here at this wedding, right? And she's been living for the last 30 years under a cloud of the birth of Jesus, right? The virgin birth, the Son of God. You know, maybe this is what some of the neighbors heard. And the Son of God, virgin birth, you know, raising eyebrows and stares and snickers in the marketplace. And you know how people, you know how cruel can people be? Yeah, exactly. And so imagine that for 30 years, you know, the looks, the whispers, you know. So 30 long years. Now, some of us, sometimes, Pastor, we get anxious when God doesn't answer a prayer in a week. Or sometimes we get worried or discouraged on a Sunday when God hasn't answered our prayer by the end of the service. Right? How many of you have come up to prayer, in all honesty, you went back, you felt the same, and you felt discouraged? Can you imagine being under a cloud for 30 years, but still having faith? I'll tell you what, I know a lot of people have assigned a divinical aspect or a divinity aspect to Mary. I don't believe that's true, but I believe that she was a special person. And I believe that there was a lot of depth to this person, more than a lot of maybe even reformers give her. But she had some depth, because in 30 years, it did not discourage her, but it built up faith. You see, there at the wedding, there were a lot of disciples and people who were friends of Jesus, but there were not many believers. How could you say that, Pastor Mel? And I'll tell you what, because in verse 11 of that chapter, you can go home and read it, it said that after this miracle was wrought, that even the disciples believed. It even convinced them to believe. And I wanted to say to you tonight, I wanted to pull out some of the positive things that I saw about this young lady who lived under this. First thing I would like to say, that she knew and was aware of her surroundings. Now, how many of you live like that? How many of you are aware and live with a consciousness of what and who is surrounding you? As a Christian, you need to have that aspect in life. You got to know that you're mission-minded. You got to know that there's a purpose. We're not spinning around rudderless or without a sail. We have a steering wheel. We have a place to do. We have a job to do. We have a mission. Amen? You're looking at me like I'm almost convincing you. When I go to Walmart, that doesn't necessarily mean I'm there to buy something. When I get gas, that doesn't necessarily mean that I'm there to fill my tank. That may have been the primary reason, but I may be at a crossroads with somebody who needs to hear something that only I can tell them. And you need to be aware of those situations. You don't need to be preachy and thou not and thou shall. You just need to be a voice that somebody could hear, okay? So she knew, and she was aware of her surroundings. She was the one that said, hey, they don't have no wine. I don't think she was just a meddling mom. You know, I don't think she was like one of those moms of the bridezilla, you know, trying to take over the wedding. But she had faith in Jesus. She didn't know, she didn't know how or what, only whom. Did you get that? Now, she knew they ran out of wine. And she didn't know how Jesus was going to do it or how he was going to get it. But she did know who to go to. Now, the enemy, when he tries to discourage me, the first thing he tells me is, how's this going to happen? How is this possible? How is it going to come through? And I look to him and I go, I don't know. That's not my part of the plan. My part is, who do you know? I don't know how and I don't know why, but I know whom. Now, today, if you don't know whom, no wonder you don't know what plan you have for your life. But good golly, she didn't know that he was going to make so many gallons of wine. But she did know that with him there, that there was something going to be, something going to happen. How did she know? Because 30 years ago, God spoke to her and sent Gabriel and said, you're going to be highly blessed, favored among women, and you're going to birth the Son of God. Now, for 30 years, she just saw him grow up. Maybe he didn't do anything spectacular, you know, I mean, but all kids are special, you know. You want to say, you know, my kids, you know. And so it's funny, but you see, the impossible need, which she identified, even though it was not directly her need. Did you hear what I just said? Because I want to repeat it again because my voice is a little cracking here. There was an impossible need which she identified, but that wasn't her need. She was aware of her surroundings. She was intervening for maybe a couple she knew, but she was, let me tell you, this wasn't directly about her. With so many people, always make it about you. It always has to be about me. And I know, and I do it, and I have to catch myself, and I have to say, it's not about me. We're on a mission. It's not about going to Walmart to buy something, although I may have that need. It's not about filling my tank with gas or going to a restaurant or wherever God sends me. I have to realize, hey, there's a need. And if there's a need, I know who to go to. And even if that need doesn't directly affect me, so what? The fact is that you're proving through your, God is going to prove through those other people's needs, my faith in him. Yeah. Can you see that connection there? This is why Pastor Mel still hasn't got out of John chapter 2. Because there's so much here to learn. Look, she took action. She let the need be verbally known. And Pastor, this man here has constantly telling us, you need to speak what you need. You need to speak it. You need to utter it. You need to put it in a vocabulary. It needs to be coherent. You need to speak these things. Amen? And she did that, right? She spoke the need. She took action. And she, not only that, but in a subtle way, and it doesn't say it directly, but she had servants with him when she approached Jesus. So she put it verbally, and she also took an act of faith and brought servants with her, right? Okay, so check this out. I'm going to finish up with this. Do you remember when she said they have no wine, and Jesus looked at her and said, woman, what does this have to do with me? It's not my time yet. Almost kind of like with an attitude, right? You ever read that? And it depends on what version you read. But most of the ones I read, it looked like he took an attitude. Amen? Okay, check this out. She was not discouraged when she received a reply she did not expect. I'm going to say that again. She was not discouraged when she received a reply she did not expect. We need to put down our agenda, put down our plan A, our plan B, and our contingency plan C, and see what God wants to do. Let me tell you something. Some of us are so weak-willed in this area that if the pastor says something contrary to what we say, we get our nose bent and we move our membership. Boy, man, there's a lot of happy faces here tonight. You want to be warmed by the fire? How's this? How's this heat? Listen. She did not get discouraged when received the reply she didn't expect. Now, I'm going to say something here, and it's scary, Pastor, because it scared me when I wrote it. Okay, because you ever point a finger to somebody, you got more pointing back at you? Sometimes, listen to this. Sometimes God allows us the last word. Did you hear that? Sometimes God allows us the last word. Because she said, they're out of wine. He said, woman, what do you want me to do? It's not my time. Was that the end of the conversation? No. What did she say? She got the last word. She didn't tell Jesus. She told the servants, whatever he tells you to do, do it. Now, that came after a discouraging word. You see how awesome this lady is? We need to grow in that area. Because sometimes God will let you, right? He let Pharaoh have the last word on the last plague, didn't he? And Pharaoh said, all of the firstborn are going to die. And it turned back on him. God was going to eliminate the children of Israel at one point, going to start again with Moses. And he gave Moses the last word, right? And he said, take me then also. And he swayed. A mighty God. Listen, sometimes God will give you the last word. So what's the last word you're going to say? Because you're going to live with it. Even if the word you get from him is discouraging, what does God expect you to do? He expects you to grow. He expects you to mature. He doesn't expect you to cower down, whimper away. It's time to man up. Or in this case, woman up, right? Listen, I looked, Pastor, and I was so thrilled with your message last Sunday about authority. And this is what I found. She used some authority in this opportunity. Albeit parental authority, but she used some authority. She told the servants, listen, whatever he does, do it. And you know what happened? And that doesn't say in the scripture, and this might be a little conjecture. But that 30-year cloud of doubt of him really being the Son of God was rolled away at that wedding. And even though the miracle was not for her, she was still blessed beyond measure with the result because it solidified her faith even more. Do you receive that word? Let's stand up, go before the Lord. That's still ringing in my ear. Do whatever he tells you. That's what we got to learn how to do. Do whatever he tells you. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity to be in your house of prayer. I thank you, dear God, for this campus and all the lives that are here today. I pray that you would minister the word powerfully and deeply in our heart, dear Father. I thank you, dear God, for even if we hear a discouraging word, that it would not discourage us, or if we hear a reply that we did not expect, dear Father, I pray that we would reach maturity in Christ to still continue our love for you, dear Father. We thank you, bless all in the name of Jesus, bless the gift and the giver as we come and receive these tithes and offering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Yeah, how you doing? Love you, man. Yeah. Hallelujah. Dwelling will be dismissed, and the high middle schoolers will be dismissed to go to their prospective classes. If you need an outline, hold your hand up. I'm going to dive into this thing, try to get through in 30 minutes. I don't know that I will, but I'm going to do my best. Oh, I'm sure the children's workers want me to take my time out there. You don't have to put up with them tomorrow morning in the office. You went over 5 minutes and they were chewing on my toes. But we'll get through it. Anybody else? Everybody got an outline now? Thank you, guys. Good to see you here. Oh, we've got a couple more over here. I'm sorry. Anybody overheated today? Amen. I want to talk to you about being in the place of God today, because I think there's some misconceptions about being in God's will. I think some of the TV preachers, maybe, I don't want to blame it all on them, some of the preachers, and through the era that I came through in the 80s and all, may have gotten people thinking that if I'm in the Lord's will, I'm never going to have another problem. If I'm in the Lord's will, I'll never be sick again. If I'm in the Lord's will, and if I am having a problem or a financial difficulty, or if I'm sick, then it must be that I am out of God's will. So let's look at some of my favorite scripture in Genesis chapter 50, verse 15. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for the wrong which we did to him?" So they sent a message to Joseph saying, now I don't remember reading where their dad actually said this, but they sent a message to Joseph saying, "Your father charged before he died, saying, 'Thus you shall say to Joseph, please forgive, I beg you, the transgression of your brothers and their sin, for they did you wrong. And now please forgive the transgression of the servants of the God of your father.' And Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also came and fell down before him and said, 'Behold, we are your servants.'" Boy, isn't this a whole different story from when they had seen him and wanted to kill him? "We are your servants." But this was exactly what Joseph had dreamed as a young boy, of the stars bowing down to the one star and the sheaves of wheat bowing down. So what God had shown him, kind of like what Pastor Mel was talking about 30 years earlier, what God had shown Joseph years earlier was now coming to pass, where his brothers would bow down before him. "We are your servants." Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid, for I am in God's place. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about this present result, to preserve many people alive." I heard Sunday, it was kind of almost too coincidental to be coincidental, but I think I heard at least 3 or 4 times, "Bloom where you're planted." Learn to bloom where you're planted. And so I thought about that as I was studying this week for this message, and how we've got to learn to be the person of God where we are and what we're going through. It doesn't have to be the right temperature. It doesn't have to be the right circumstances. It doesn't have to be perfect around us for us to be the person of God. We have to learn to do where we're at, because a lot of times when we're in the place of God or God's place, it's not a very comfortable place. It's not a convenient place. God has probably used adversity in my life to direct me more than he's used blessing. Okay, I got amens over here. Let's try it over here. God has probably taught me more and directed my life more through adversity He may have directed me more through closed doors than open doors. He may have had more to do with my direction through people rejecting me than people accepting me. And so Joseph said, you don't have to be afraid because of what you did, I'm in the place of God. So we have to learn to bloom where we're planted. Don't spend your life looking over the next hill. I can remember as a young pastor, I started pastoring a church at 19. And I can remember thinking, because everybody in the church, there were people in my youth group older than me. And so I can remember at 19 years of age thinking, boy, I can't wait till I get old enough for people to take me seriously. And I even had one guy was coming to my church. He said, you can't be my pastor. I've got shoes older than you. And so I can remember thinking, and Mel remembers thinking that too, and or not thinking that, but when I was in that place, and I hope not thinking that. But anyway, but I remember that, and I remember thinking, when I get older, people will take me seriously. When I get older, my ministry will take a new direction. When I get older, and so now that I'm older, if we're not careful, we will spend half of our life looking over the next hill and around the next corner, and the other half looking in the rearview mirror and thinking, boy, if I had the strength I had when I was 20, boy, if I knew then what I know now, if I had that strength and this experience. So we have to learn to be where our feet are. We have to learn to make the most of things where we are, because life will give you plenty of excuses for failure. Well, you know, if you'd have just been born somewhere else, if you'd have been born to other parents, if you'd have been better looking, whatever, life will give you plenty of excuses for failure. We can't use those excuses. We have to make the most of what God has given us. Make the most of where God has put you, amen? So I read something this week I thought was really interesting. It said, you can't change the people around you, but you can change the people around you. You can't change the people around you, but you can change the people around you. In other words, you can't make people change, but you can change who the people are. And some of us need to change the people that are speaking into our lives. Some of us need to change. We would be doing better if we had people giving us better words. We would be doing better if we were getting better input. You got to get rid of negative Nancy.
That's right.
You got to get rid of those bad influences that are taking you down the wrong roads and causing you to go the wrong directions. You can't change. You see, I think a lot of times what we try to do is keep those people around us with hopes that they're going to change. Well, maybe if I just hang out with them a little longer. Maybe if I just stay with them a little longer. And so we keep those people around, and what winds up happening, instead of them changing, we begin to accept their bad behavior. Instead of them changing, we begin to make excuses for their bad behavior. So sometimes if you can't change the people around you, you need to change the people around you. Are you with me still? Sometimes you have to change your inner circle. It's a good example of this is in Jesus. Jesus picked 12 men to be his disciples. But when he had business to take care of, he narrowed it down to 3. He didn't take all 12 into Jairus' house to pray for his daughter. He didn't take all 12 up on the Mountain of Transfiguration. He didn't take all 12 into the garden to pray when he was facing death. He took Peter, James, and John. Why? Because he knew the importance of who you allow to be speaking into your life and being in your inner circle. So when he had to get down to business and really wrestle for eternity, he left doubting Thomas and greedy Judas behind. And sometimes you got to get rid of doubting Thomas and greedy Judas. Oh, I'm preaching good tonight. Teaching good tonight. So we see on our study tonight a valuable lesson that comes out of, though the place of God is not always a happy place, it's not always a comfortable place, we still have to believe it is the place of God. Joseph went from being hated by his brothers to being sold into slavery and then being lied on in slavery and going into prison and forgot about and neglected. And so we see, but what he did was even in the midst of all of that, that was the opposite of what his dream that God gave him was, he still was unwilling to let go of his dream, and he still bloomed where he was at. Let's look at how Joseph handled the place of God. Number one, Joseph was willing to forgive. If you're going to make full use of being in the place of God, you have to forgive. Jesus prayed that prayer, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. He told them, said, as you forgive, you will be forgiven. You retain other sins, your sins will be retained. So let's look at this in Genesis 50 and 15. Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead. They said, what if Joseph bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong which we did to him? Joseph's brothers hated him because he had a dream in Genesis 37 and 18. When they saw him from a distance and before he came close to them, they plotted against him to put him to death. They said to one another, here comes the dreamer. Now then, come, let us kill him, throw him into one of the pits, and we will say a beast devoured him. Then let's see what will become of his dreams. Joseph didn't really do anything to merit such hatred. I mean, he dreamed about his brothers bowing down and serving him. He dreamed about that, but he didn't really do anything to bring about such a hatred on himself other than the jealousy of his brothers. He dreamed, like I said, he dreamed, one dream he had was there were stars there and all the other stars bowed down to the one star. He dreamed about stacks of wheat or sheaves of wheat and all the other sheaves bowed down to that one sheaf. And even Joseph's dad said, what are you saying, son? Even me and your mom are going to bow down to you one day? Well, the problem was it wasn't Joseph saying it. It was God saying it. And so that was all that he had done that caused them to hate him so bad. Many times in the place of God, it'll be a place where people will not like you and they won't even need a reason. You'll be in the place of God and it may be a job and the boss won't like you. You'll be in the place of God and God will send you somewhere and you'll go in there and automatically people just won't like the sound of your voice and they'll go from 0 to 100 hating you just in an instant. And you say, well, I don't understand what's going on. I didn't do anything to them. You don't have to do anything. Your spirit and their spirit don't jihah. That's a farm term, jihah, you know. G is left and ha is right. That's the way you drive a mule. But anyway, your spirit and their spirit won't mesh. It won't connect because their spirit is not right and your spirit is the spirit of God. And so you'll go in and for no reason at all, people won't like you and supervisors won't like you. And you'll wonder, what in the world is going on? I'll tell you what's going on. There's a spiritual warfare taking place. And so you'll go in, and just like Joseph with his brothers, they hated him enough to kill him, and for no reason at all. And so they sold him into slavery, and they were plotting to kill him. But Joseph was willing to forgive his brothers. Genesis 50 and 19, Joseph said to them, do not be afraid, for I am in God's place. Now let me tell you, here's what the enemy tries to do. It's kind of like a few weeks ago when I was teaching on the man possessed with a legion of demons. Legion is about, I think, 650 or something like that demons, and so he was possessed with a legion of demons. I mean, I'm sorry, not 600, 2600, 2600 demons, I think it is, 25, something like that. But anyway, he was possessed with all these demons, and so they tried to bind him. They couldn't bind him. They couldn't. He would spend his time in the graveyard among the dead. The reason the devil does a lot and makes these wedges is because we're sent to those people, and so what the enemy wants us to do is not like those people and disassociate from those people and have nothing to do with those people, so we can't win those people. So what he does is make them get on the attack so we will withdraw rather than win them to the Lord. Many times the person God sent you to a place to win and to reach is the person that hates you the most. And so what the enemy does is try to start a war between the two of you so you won't win them to Jesus. Can I get an amen? Amen? Joseph was willing to forgive them. He realized that God used his brothers to get him in the place of God. God used the negative, hateful bitter, mean actions of his brothers to move him into the place of God. Now, that's not what we like. We like the sweet stuff. We want angels to come down and say, come on, little Oogie Boogie, let me show you over here. This is where you got to go. Let's go this way. Let me hold your hand. Come on. Let me get everything out of your way. Come on. You know, that's not how God does it. A lot of times God sends the hateful and the mean to move us into the place of God. So a lot of times God sends the things that we are not comfortable with and we're not happy about. He realized God used his brothers. So here's what we've got to do. The people that we want to be upset with, I'll put it that way. I started to say just walk up and slap. That person you just left to just go up and say, you need to go up and say, you know what? Thank you so much. Because of what you did, I'm in the place of God. I know you were talking about me, but because of what you said, I am in the place of God. Because you wouldn't let me have that and do that and go, now I am in the place of God. Because what you meant for evil, God has turned around for good. We need to thank those people, amen? So he forgave them. Forgiveness is more for us than it is for them. You know the story, Matthew 18 and 32. Then summoning him, the Lord said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have also had mercy on your fellow slave? And in the same way that I had mercy on you. And his Lord, moved with anger, handed him over to the torturers until he should repay all that was owed to him. My heavenly Father will also do the same to you if each of you does not forgive his brother from his heart. Wow. Forgiveness is, if for me to forgive is more for me than it is the person I'm forgiving. Well, you know, the Bible says if your brother asks you to forgive him, you forgive him. But what if they don't ask? Forgive them anyway. It's not for them. For, before, for means prior to, and give means without cost. Prior to, without any expectation, forgive them. And you might have to do it every day. There's some people I've been forgiven for 10 years. Yeah. And I think I'm over it and doing good. And then I'll see them again. Or they'll say something else. Or I'll hear something they say. And they go, I forgive them again, Lord. Because I have disappointed God many, 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 many times. So he was willing to forgive is how he got in the place of God. Willing to forgive. When we don't forgive, we put our own selves into bondage. Number two, he held on to his faith. He held on to his faith. Genesis 50 and 19. But Joseph said to them, do not be afraid, for I am in God's place. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about this present result to preserve many people alive. It didn't look like what he had dreamed, but he held on to his faith. It didn't look like where God said he was going to take him, but he held on to his faith. Genesis 37. Then some Midianite traders passed by, so they pulled him up and lifted Joseph out of the pit and sold him into the Ishmaelites, or to the Ishmaelites. It must have been some of your relatives. That's Pastor Mel's whole name, Ishmael. For 20 shekels of silver. And they brought Joseph into Egypt. His brothers threw him into what was basically a dry well, originally planning to kill him and leave him there. But then they saw opportunity. Well, really what happened was Benjamin, I think, said, you know, no, let's don't kill him. We won't get any profit for that. And so to save his life, they sold him into slavery. And so they sold him into slavery, and he became a slave. That was not what he dreamed. He dreamed about being a great person that they were bowing to. Now he was a slave doing the menial task of a slave. Here's what you got to understand about being in the place of God. Where you are may not look like what God showed you. Where you are now, where you are in the place may not, you know, you got GPS, you ever follow GPS, and you say, well, I put in where I was supposed to go, but this does not look like where I was supposed to go. God's perfect system, his GPS, sometimes takes us through things that don't look like, you know, and that happened all through the Bible. Jonah was sent to Nineveh, but he had to go through the belly of the whale, and he said even in the belly of hell, on his way to where he went. Moses had to spend 40 years wandering around the wilderness before he got to the place that God had for him. All through the Bible. So even when they crucified Jesus on the cross, it didn't look like what the disciples thought what God was going to do should look like. So don't get excited if where you are doesn't look like what God showed you. I heard Bishop Miller say one time, he was up in Canada or somewhere, and snow was about 3 feet deep, and it was cold, 30 below zero, and all that. He said he turned on the TV, and there was a commercial for Disney World. And he said that commercial for Disney World looked so good. You saw families skipping through, you know, holding hands. You saw the rides. You saw them eating the big hamburger. And then he said it just looked so good. I about got on a plane and left my meeting and went to Florida where it was nice. He said, but what they didn't show you was, first of all, you had to drive a day or two to get there. Then you had to spend 2 or 3 hours waiting to get in the park and get parked. Then you had to spend another hour at the gate. You had to spend a couple $100 for the ticket to get in. Then you had to wait an hour for each ride. Then you had to pay $20 for a hamburger and $10 for a drink. And then you might luckily get on 4 or 5 rides before the day was over. And he said, they didn't show you all that. He said, that's what prophecy is. Prophecy is just the commercials. It doesn't show you all the bad stuff you got to go through to get to the good stuff. And so what God does is he gives us the highlights. And so in the place of God, you're going to find yourself a lot of times in a place that doesn't look like where God said you were going. Now, some of the detours we bring on ourselves, but we won't go into that this study. So even though he had favor with Potiphar, the devil didn't leave him alone in the place of God. The devil is not going to leave you alone because you're in the place of God. Right. I was talking with somebody this week, and they're talking about, I believe God hit. Man, Sunday we had so many testimonies about people that got healed, and Cain, somebody came in on a cane, left with it rolled up in their purse, and just miracles that happened Sunday. And somebody was talking to me about, well, I know God touched me, and I know I had a miracle, but it's almost like it's coming back on me. The devil's not going to leave you alone in the place of God. The devil is not going to, you get healed, he's not going to just roll over and play dead. He's going to try to convince you you're not healed. You get a miracle, he's going to try to talk you out of your miracle. So even though he had the favor of God, look at Genesis 39, number B on your outline. Now, when his master heard the words of his wife, which she spoke to him, saying, this is what your slave did to me. And of course we know, she tried to get him, Joseph, to lie with her. He refused to do it. He would not betray his master. So she lied and said he tried to rape her. And so she told her husband and said, when he heard this, his anger burned. So Joseph's master took him and put him into the jail at the place where the king's prisoners were confined. And he was there in jail. Being in the place of God does not mean easy sailing. Being in the place of God does not mean the devil's going to leave you alone. Being in the place of God does not mean that we're going to be exempt from the lies of the enemy. The enemy is always trying to take your promise away. I mean, you're at the door of your promise. It's about to open up, and the devil's standing there trying to tell you, why don't you go, why don't you give up, why don't you quit, like he did Israel. So being in the place of God, just because it's not smooth sailing, does not mean you're not in the place of God. Number C, even then God's hand was still on him. Genesis 39 and 21. But the Lord was with Joseph and extended kindness to him and gave him favor in the sight of the chief jailer. The chief jailer committed Joseph to Joseph's charge all the prisoners who were in the jail, so that whatever was done there, he was responsible for it. The devil tries to knock you down, and God gives you a promotion in jail. The Bible said it, I'm going to read it in a minute. He went to work for Potiphar, and Potiphar saw the hand of the Lord was on him, and everything he did prospered. He put him over everything. So the devil said, well, I'll fix him. I'll just tell a big lie on him, and I'll get him knocked down. Da, da, da. He did that. What happened? He gets blessed again. Now he's running to jail. If you got to be in jail, you want to run to jail. Amen. You don't have to act like you know what I'm talking about. If we'll stay faithful, God will stay faithful. Even if they lie on you, you stay faithful to God. Even if they falsely accuse you, stay faithful to God. And God will turn things around. The jail that's meant to hold you, you'll be running the thing. on what I was talking about. In number D, Genesis 39 and 3. Now the master saw, this is Potiphar, saw the Lord was with him and how he, the Lord caused all that he did to prosper in his hand. So Joseph found favor in his sight and became the personal servant, and he made him overseer over his house and all that he owned and put this in his charge. That's what I'm saying. Even in the bad places, if you're in the place of God, God will bless you and show you favor. And then when they all come piling on you, guess what? You're just going to come right through it. You're going to come out smelling like a rose. Smelling like something else. Number three, what you have to learn to do is you have to forgive when you're in the place of God. You have to hold on to the faith in the place of God. And number three, you have to minister out of the place of God. See, here's what a lot of people do. Well, when I get my pulpit, when I get my microphone, when I get my stage, when I get my church, when I get my, no. The place of God's going to take you through places, and it's just like Pastor Mel was saying, and we've got to speak the word out of those places. We got to speak the word of God out of those places when it doesn't look like what God had showed us, when it doesn't look like what we thought God was going to do in our lives. We got to still be willing to speak that word of God out of those rough places. Are you with me? Look at Genesis 40 and 5. Then the cupbearer and the baker of the king of Egypt, who were confined in jail, both had a dream that same night, each man with his own dream and each dream with his own interpretation. When Joseph came to them in the morning and observed them, behold, they were dejected. And he asked Pharaoh's officials, who were with him in confinement in his master's house, why are your faces so sad today? You know what? If I'd been falsely accused, lied on, sold by my brothers into slavery, and then built myself up and then got thrown into prison for lied on, the last thing I'd be worried about is why some other joker was sad. Right. I'm sorry, I know I'm supposed to be the pastor and I'm supposed to be, but I'm afraid my pastoral anointing would be running a little thin by about 15 or 20 years of being a slave and in jail. And so, but Joseph sees these two guys who hadn't been in there that long, came from the palace, living the big life, and he goes up and said, what's wrong? I could tell something's wrong. What's wrong? You know, how different would church be if when we came, we would be more aware of what's wrong with others than just what we want? I mean, just saying. If we were more aware and concerned with praying for other people and getting their needs, because that's what's important about the place of God. You got to learn to minister out of the place of God, even if it's the prison, even if it's in a depressing place, a place where we didn't think or want to be. He was willing to minister out of that place. Are you with me still? If the devil can keep you preoccupied with your own troubles, where you won't use your gifts, he will keep you in prison. If he can keep us down and keep us from being anointed and being concerned with others, he'll keep you down. The Bible talks about going from glory to glory and blessing to blessing, but a lot of people go from problem to problem and drama to drama because the devil knows he can preoccupy us with that or preoccupy some people with that. And so they're always caught up in some drama and some problem because the enemy keeps them from being effective because they don't take time to minister out of their prison. Thank you, Pastor. Can I have another? If Satan can, he wants to turn, number B, he wants to turn our joy into tears and our praise into crying. Look at Psalms 137, how when the Philistines asked Israel to sing them one of the songs. And by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. And upon the willows in the midst of it, we hung our harps. For there our captors demanded of us a song or songs, and our tormentors mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. But their reply is, how can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? Because sometimes the place of the Lord is a foreign place. Sometimes the place of the Lord is an unfamiliar place. Sometimes the place of the Lord is a place that we didn't expect to be. And so Israel said, we can't worship. We're in a foreign place. We can't worship. We're not in our temple. We're not on 1023 West Georgia Road. We can't worship. We're not in church. We don't have the band. We don't have the lights and the screen. We can't worship. Yes, you can. We can't worship. We're at the hospital. We can't worship. Yes, sing the songs of Zion wherever you are. The enemy wants to turn your joy into sorrow and your praise into complaining. Don't whine, shine. You need to start saying that to people. Stop whining, start shining.
Hallelujah, Pastor.
It's not time to quit because it's not where we thought we were going to be. Ecclesiastes 3 tells us about a new everything. There is an appointed time. For everything, there is a season under for every event under heaven. And I read through that thing, and it's interesting. There's one thing I don't see a time and a place for, and that is for quitting. There's a time to gather, a time to scatter, a time to build, a time to tear down, a time to dance, a time to mourn. But there's nowhere does he say it's time to quit. So don't you let the enemy steal your praise and your worship. As a matter of fact, let's move on down. Because what you have to believe in is the end result. The vision God gave you, the dream God gave you will come eventually if you hang on and don't give up. You may go through the prison. You may go through the slave house. You may go through other places. But you just keep singing and you just keep worshiping and you just keep holding on to God because it will take you where God said you were going to go. And all of hell won't stop you from getting there. Instead of being worried about it, you've got to say, no. It's all right. I'm in the place of God. What? But you're under attack. I'm in the place of God. But they hate you, but I'm in the place of God. But they lied on you, I'm in the place of God. But they said this about you, I'm in the place of God. What the enemy meant for evil, God turns around for good. Man, if I ever believed that, and I believed that for 40 nearly years of ministry, I believed that. But after the last 2 years of our life, I know that more now than I've ever known in my whole entire life. I'm in the place of God. So Isaiah 61 and 2, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord, the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant those who mourn in Zion, giving them a garland instead of ashes, oil of gladness instead of mourning, a mantle of praise instead of spirit of fainting. So they will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. Don't let the enemy steal your praise. That's right. You go ahead and praise God. Because even in the worst of circumstances, if I'm in the place of God, I'm still in the favor of God.
That's right.
Even if I can't explain it, I can't tell you how, when, or where. I'm still in the favor of God. And I'm in the place of God. So we need to understand the place of God is not always comfortable. It's not always cushy. It's not always where we have everything at the snap of a finger. But the place of God is always a place where we have the favor of God. Amen. You received this word tonight. Come on, amen. Go ahead, stand up on your feet. Father, I thank you that I believe in my heart, with all my heart, I'm in the place of God. And as long as I'm in the place of God, what the enemy means for evil, God's going to turn around for good. The attacks of the enemy, the lies of the enemy, the false accusations of the enemy, the things the enemy tries to throw against me, as long as I'm in the place of God, I'm in the favor of God. Oh God, I thank you for being in the place of God. And I pray that you just keep us in your will and keep us in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you.